Today's video I'm filming on my phone like I did at the beginning of my channel, really because anybody can film videos on their phone, just lo-fi, easy to do this, to become a creator. And I'm going to tell you a story on how creators toppled the music business, but it's really not creators, it's really you, the audience, toppled the music business. But we're going to do this while taking a walk at the park because it's a beautiful sunny day. It's a little windy. Let's go. So it's 1996. I'm living here in Atlanta, living with my buddy Rich and three other musicians in this house. We have bands coming in and out. Rich books two of the main clubs in town. My buddy Mark and I decide to start this project. So I borrow a DA88 digital tape machine. We start writing songs with this idea that we're going to put this band together, which eventually became Billionaire. In February of that year, 1996, Bill Clinton signed the Telecommunications Act of 1996. Because of that, these huge media companies like Clear Channel, Cumulus, started buying up all these radio stations. And the homogenization of radio started to happen. They'd buy all these things. They'd fire the program directors, a lot of the program directors that would break local bands. And local bands used to be broken by local radio stations in the day. They had autonomy to do things like that. But then you have people that never even come into the cities running the radio stations and making the playlists. It's more of a generic playlist. Atlanta not being one of those. We had 99X that my dear friend Leslie Fram programmed. And she had the autonomy to break artists. She could play whatever she wanted, but that was an unusual thing. So because of this, we didn't realize what was coming down the pike. So we start our band. We finally get a record offer, 1998. We go in and we make our first major label record. We spend $483,000 on a record. Let me play you a song here so you can get a vibe for what we sounded like. Picture and read me what it says. I don't believe in heaven. I've never been to that place. And these are the reasons for today. And these are the seasons of today. As you can hear, this is a really cool song, but it's not commercial. We are not a commercial band at all. So the fact that we got a record deal when we didn't have any radio songs was pretty unusual. But record labels would take chances on artists back then in 1998. But in 1999, we release our record and I get this call from our lawyer. Hey, were you watching the news today? I said, no. Why? Well, PolyGram just got bought out by Universal. So what does that mean? That means that you guys are dropped. And so I went back to the hotel room where we were staying. I think it was Little Rock. So I went and woke up the guys and I told them this. We got in the van, we drove back to Atlanta. Those guys got jobs working. But the overarching thing that was going on in the music business that we were realizing is right around the time that we got dropped, Napster started. You know, kids started file sharing through Napster. The year 2000 was the biggest year in the music business in sales. All these labels, that's when you're having NSYNC, the Backstreet Boys, all this stuff. And then in rock, you had Linkin Park and you had Creed and you had all these bands that were selling millions and millions of, tens of millions of records. And I start producing and I start having success with some bands. I worked with the band Shinedown in 2002 on some of their first record that was ended up being a double platinum record. And that's one of the reasons that I have gear in my studio was really from that record. It was that long ago. It's over 20 years at this point. But I didn't realize until probably 2 years later, 2004, when the budgets from the major labels started going down. I was getting major label records at the time. But then it'd be like, instead of having $250,000, $350,000 to make a record, where you'd go to a studio. I'd get paid 3,000 bucks a track plus 3 points. A point, that means 3 percentage points. You get that out of the artist. The artist, a new artist back then, would get 13 percentage points. So if a record sold for 10 bucks, which they didn't, they sold for 20 bucks CD. So if a record sold for $10, out of that $10, the band got $1.30, 13%. Out of their 13%, I get paid, the producer gets paid from the band. So I got another 30 cents from that. Okay, so they paid me. So they really got $1 a record. I got 30 cents a record. So if you had a platinum record, you would make $300,000. If you had a triple platinum record, which you'd have to have a big record, you'd make $1 million. Or close to $1 million, right? So $900,000. Future Rick here. I forgot to mention one thing. So not only is it outrageous that the labels were only paying the artists 13%, and out of that, the artists were paying the producer 3%, but the mixer was getting 1%. So the artist was actually making 9%, okay? So they were making 90 cents per record, not a dollar per record. One of the reasons I started my studio in 2005, I opened my studio up, was because there were no budgets like that anymore. Basically, you started having budgets of 150 grand. That's all in, where I'd have to mix the record. I'd deliver the record mixed. There was no money for rentals. There was no money for session players. And all the bands had to have people that wrote songs with them. Now, I was one of the guys that got work, because not only could I write songs with the bands, but I could also play their parts if need be. And I could play any auxiliary parts. If it needed extra guitar parts, if it needed organ parts, keyboard parts, pads, if it needed a string arrangement, I could write the arrangement and I'd hire a small group of people and then we'd triple track it so it sounded like a string orchestra. Whatever the songs needed, I could provide. And I would provide a finished record for maybe $150,000 at the time. Then it'd be $75,000. Then it would be $50,000. And by the time 2008 came, that was pretty much it with major label deals. They did not sign artists that weren't really successful then. The consolidation of the music business was complete. And then by 2012 or so, the rock completely disappeared in mainstream popular music, basically. There were still popular bands, but the era of all those hard rock bands, the Nickelbacks, the bands that sold millions of records, in Linkin Parks, had pretty much run their course. So there wasn't any work, there wasn't any money to be made for labels from that. I wasn't doing that kind of music. I was doing mostly metal bands, and metal was going underground again. Now, I did other bands other than metal bands. I worked with a band called Need to Breathe. I did 3 records with them. They're a rock band that was, you know, more like a Americana, maybe you'd call them. And I was writing with bands. Well, one of the bands I wrote with was a band called Parmalee in 2007. I've told that story on here. Parmalee had a song called Carolina that we wrote in 2007. In 2013, they got a record deal as a country band. They recut this song a half step lower. And in February, it went out to radio. And remarkably, the song went number one on December 9th, 2013. Million seller number one song. So I had a number one song as a writer, a country song, the only country song I'd ever written. So I went to Nashville, started writing with all the top country writers. And I did that for probably 3-4 months. And then I realized that if you didn't live in Nashville, that there was no future in that. So I gave up on that. Then we're talking about 2015. I'm basically working with independent artists. All of a sudden, I had this video with my son Dylan in December of 2015. What's this?
C augmented over D flat augmented.
Okay, sing a B flat.
Mm.
Very good. What's this chord? Sing an F sharp. Excellent. What's this chord?
A minor over D flat major.
Great. What's this chord?
Yeah, minor over F major.
The next day, the video blew up on Facebook. I also put a copy up on YouTube at the same time. Didn't go back to my YouTube channel. I had no videos on YouTube other than videos of my kids. And That video ended up getting 22 million views on Facebook during that week. Well, I came back to YouTube about 3 days later and it was at 500,000. Now, at that time, since I didn't have any other videos, I had 47 subscribers. So I really started my channel with 47 subscribers. So I started from scratch with these videos, making all the videos that you know, and then became this channel. So I was thinking about this when I was on my walk. If you weren't on a major label back then, it was almost impossible. I'm talking all the way until 2008 or so. It was almost impossible to be successful. You had to be on one because you couldn't get on radio and you couldn't get in record stores. They own the distribution. They own the radio stations, basically. Because of social media, right, you can get to millions of people. My channel has had 540 million, 550 million views now over these last 6.5 years. My channel will be 7 years old in June of this year. And I'm going to be 61 years old coming up. So there's artists that have broken through YouTube, through TikTok, through Instagram, through Facebook, but mainly through YouTube and through TikTok. When I say broken, I mean they've gone from here to some of them being on major labels. I mean, Justin Bieber was really a YouTube star back in the day before he was a big star. There's a singer, Tate McRae, an artist who's had a number one song. She's on RCA Records. She's got 32 million monthly listeners on Spotify. She's a pop artist and had a huge hit, but she started on YouTube when she was 14. She's probably 19, 20 years old now. And then you can be known as a music teacher, right? Like this channel, you can be known as having a music channel because YouTube or TikTok or Instagram or Facebook are distribution networks that are open to anyone that wants to put out content. That is the amazing part of this, is that you do not need to be part of a huge corporation. I mean, these are huge corporations, right? YouTube is a big corporation, part of Google. But I make whatever content I want on here, and people can choose to watch it or not. If it's interesting, they watch it. But I can get my videos out to millions of people. My channel's been successful enough that I've gotten to interview a lot of well-known legendary musicians. And that's because you guys come back and watch the videos. I think we're in a much better place now, really, than we were. The one good thing about the old days, and I don't mean to be old man yells about clouds, is that there used to be these gatekeepers. That was the good and bad part. The gatekeepers were the A&R people. There were some good A&R people back in the day that found great bands. There was an A&R people that signed Led Zeppelin. You know, there's A&R people that signed Genesis and Yes and whoever. I mean, people signed all those bands that we know and love. Radiohead, and they promoted them. And that's why we know about them. If they didn't promote them, we would not know about them. They needed to put that money in there and get them, you know, known enough. So that's the good and bad of this. Now there's the gatekeepers are basically you guys. You decide how long you watch the videos. You decide which videos to watch, which channels to watch, which channels to stop watching, whatever it is. That's my musing of today. I've been thinking a lot about this lately. I always come back to this thing that how amazing this is, you know, being on YouTube, for example. And really, anybody can do it. That's the amazing thing. If you have something that people are interested in, it doesn't matter. You can get a following. You can, you know, you can be successful at this. Anyhow, don't forget to hit the subscribe button. More people are unsubscribed on my channel than subscribed. And leave a comment. Let me know your thoughts. Thanks so much for watching.